That's the stand that the colonial assemblies took, that any taxes other than the ones they levy, because their people have say, are illegal. So the Stamp Act of 1765 in the minds of the colonial assemblies was illegal. That's how they viewed it. Now this was kind of an interesting story. Well, what happened is only 9 colonies got involved with this. How many we got? 13. Only 9 colonial assemblies got involved, and they all got together and they met in New York City in October of 1765. So delegates from 9 colonies that represented the colonial assemblies in 9 colonies all met together in October of 1765 in New York City. What are they meeting for? To discuss how they're going to protest these taxes and come up with a unified stand, okay, on how they're going to do this. What do you think it was called when all 9 of these colonial assemblies were represented by delegates in New York City in October of 1765? Stamp Act Congress. So they got themselves together, all 9 delegates from 9 colonies. They met New York City in October of 1765, and that meeting became known in American history as the Stamp Act Congress. Now, do you understand, so I don't confuse you here, that all the members of the colonial assemblies didn't go to New York City. Each assembly sent what? A delegate, a representative, okay? And those 9 delegates met in October of 1765 in New York City, and this would be known as the Stamp Act Congress. And basically, 3 important things were accomplished by these delegates during the time they met together in New York City. They came up with a solidarity, a solid stand, that we're going to stand together as 9 colonies under and give these 3 feelings or beliefs to the British. Now, the first one might surprise you. So during this Stamp Act Congress meeting, 3 important things were accomplished. Number 1, delegates asserted their loyalty to the king. They asserted their loyalty to the king and promised all due subordination to Parliament. First thing they did when they got there is they asserted their loyalty to the king and promised, quote, all due subordination to Parliament. I'll repeat that a couple times because it's lengthy. So the first thing delegates did at the Stamp Act Congress is they asserted their loyalty to the king and promised, quote, all due subordination to Parliament. Okay, first of all, Cherith, what is asserting their loyalty to the king mean?
They're establishing that they are all loyal
to the king. So that, you know, even though they're mad, they're saying, hey, we get it. We're citizens of Great Britain. We're going to assert our loyalty to the king. What do they mean, Taylor, by promising, quote, all due subordination to Parliament? Okay, now I want you, this is a good point. Anybody in here been in trouble and they wrote on your discipline notice that you were insubordinate? You ever heard that term? Insubordinate means you're not doing what you're supposed to do. Somebody tells you what to do and you tell them to pound sand, you're being insubordinate. So being subordinate is doing what you're supposed to do. So if they promise all due subordination, that means they're promising they're going to do what they're told by Parliament. Okay, now that's strange, but that's what they came up with first. Okay, the second thing they stated is they were going to resist all taxes levied without the consent of their own legislatures. They vowed to resist all taxes levied without the consent of their own legislators. They vowed to resist all taxes levied without the consent of their own legislatures. Okay, so what are they saying, Paris?
So, If Parliament gives them a pass, then they're going to fight against it because they don't have a say in this.
Okay, and we'll even go a little farther, that she has a good example, but South Carolina's only going to be willing to do taxes that their own legislature does. So if Georgia passes a law, South Carolina's not gonna follow it. So what they're saying basically is, the only taxes we're paying are the ones that our own colonial legislatures or assemblies pass. That's what they're saying. And the third thing they did, which is probably the most important, is all colonial merchants, by virtue of this meeting, all colonial merchants agreed to and signed non-importation agreements. All colonial merchants that were represented by these nine delegates agreed to and signed non-importation agreements. Non-importation agreements. Okay, so let me repeat that again. All colonial merchants that were represented by these nine delegates agreed to and signed non-importation agreements. What does that mean? Anybody know what that means? Non-importation agreements.
So they're not going to import any goods from out of the colonies? Or?
That's right. They're not going to import any goods out of the colonies. They're not going to purchase any goods from, not out of the colonies, but who? Britain. So what these colonial merchants are saying is, we are no longer going to purchase any British goods, and we're no longer going to import any British goods into America. They're going to cut off Britain at the knees on trade. You think Britain depends on the American colonies for trade? Yeah. So that's a big one. Now, is that going to hurt them? Is that going to make, they're going to suffer a little on that too? They are, but they're willing to make a stand.
Are they not trading with other countries either then?
Well, they, no, they'll trade with every other country they can. That's the point. They're going to go crazy with everybody but Britain. Remember, they're trying to charge you money before in the Sugar Act on anything they imported in from other countries outside the British Empire. They don't like that either. So what they're saying is, the hell with you. We're going to sign these non-importation agreements. We're not going to buy anything from Great Britain. We're not going to import anything from Great Britain. And let's see how they like that. Okay? They didn't like it. Well, within a few months of signing these non-importation agreements, any products made in Great Britain virtually vanished from the colonial stores and warehouses. They were getting everything from other countries. Other countries. That's protesting, man. I'm not kidding you. Okay? Now, that was the non-violent approach. Okay? And this is where we start kind of the radical protesting that leads us to more problems, that leads us to an American Revolution. Okay? Now, there were some American colonists who wanted to show their opposition personally to the Stamp Act. And so these American colonists organized, grouped, and called themselves the Sons of Liberty. Okay? So the delegates and the legislatures did the three things I talked about, but there were American colonists out there that said, I've had enough of this, and I'd like to protest individually. So they formed groups of protesters called the Sons of Liberty. And I'm going to give you five different actions they took to protest the Stamp Act. Okay, five different actions that the Sons of Liberty took to protest the Stamp Act. They weren't exactly very politically correct in their protests. Okay? First thing they did, they simply rioted in large towns. They rioted in large towns to show their protest. Secondly, they destroyed the offices of stamp tax collectors. They went in and destroyed the offices of those individuals who collected tax on the Stamp Act. Stamp Act collectors. Okay, so they destroyed the offices of stamp tax collectors. What do you think they did? They took the stamps from the stamp act collectors' offices and stamped everything and then burned them in the streets. That's the third thing. They burned stamps in the streets. Not only the stamps, but anything that had a stamp on it. Does that make sense? So they took these stamps that they were putting on to show that you paid your taxes, and they burnt the stamps and anything they could find with a stamp on it. So they burnt stamps in the streets. Fourth thing they did is they destroyed houses that belonged to royal officials. Royal is another name for British. Okay? They destroyed homes of royal officials. These guys weren't messing around. Now, do you think everybody believed what all these radicals thought? No, I mean, not everybody. So, what the Sons of Liberty did, number five, if they thought you were being loyal to the crown, or you were sympathetic to Great Britain, what did they do to you? You've heard this, like, tarred and feathered them. So they tarred and feathered anyone they thought was sympathetic to Great Britain. So if you stood up and said, hey, I don't agree that you guys are burning down the homes of these royal officials, they'd just take you out and tar and feather you. I think that would be awful. I mean, it wouldn't be painful, but can you imagine? Now, how did the British react to the Sons of Liberty and their actions? What do you think they had to do? And how'd they do that? They could have backed off on the stamp act, which is a good point. But or they could have what? Well, and how would they restore order? How would they get people under control? What would they send to America? Troops. So as a result of the actions of the Sons of Liberty, the British sent thousands of troops to America to try to restore order. To give an example, shortly after the actions of the Sons of Liberty, the town of Boston, Massachusetts, had 4,000 colonial troops in that city alone, keeping order. So, once the British found out about these actions by the Sons of Liberty, the rebellion, they sent many, many soldiers to restore order in the colonies. And then by 1770, there were 4,000 soldiers, British soldiers, in Boston alone. Now, you might think, well, what's 4,000 mean? Guess how many people lived in Boston? They had one soldier for every five colonists. Now, that's really fortifying the city, man. One soldier to look after every five colonists. So they made an impact. And that's another thing that irritated American colonists in Massachusetts, especially in Boston, is they didn't like the presence of all these British troops. One for every five person. Okay? 400 kids in this school. Okay? Let's say there's 500. Make the math easy if you're a math. So how many police officers would be in this school making sure you behave yourself if you got one for every five people? You have 100 police officers. Can you imagine coming to school every day and having 100 police officers in here walking around school making sure you're behaving? That's what the people of Boston were feeling. Just think about that. That puts it in perspective a little bit. Okay? I don't think anybody liked that. All right. That takes us to our next subtopic, which is what Dalton was hitting all over. Repeal of the Stamp Act. That means repeal means get rid of it. Repeal of the Stamp Act. Now we're going to kind of set this up a little bit. We won't finish this thing at all. But obviously, as we mentioned, the British Parliament received the news of this colonial resistance, right? And here was the quote that King George III said when he heard about all this unrest in the colonies. He said, quote, and again, if I want you to write it down, what would I say? Write it down. I'm not telling you to write it down. Just listen. He said, King George III, when he heard about this unrest and this colonial resistance in America, he said, quote, it is undoubtedly the most serious matter that has ever came before Parliament. Okay, that's pretty easy. He's starting to sense that we're getting some resistance from the American colonies. It's serious, and Parliament's going to have to deal with it. How are you going to deal with these resisting colonies? So he figured it out pretty quick. Now, let's just end the day by thinking, what really caused, and we'll get into detail on it tomorrow, but what really caused the repeal of the Stamp Act? What really caused it? What was the thing that made the British say, we better back off? What was it? If you were the British, and you were in this situation, you listened to everything I've told you today, and you're in Parliament, what's the thing bothering you the most about the colonial resistance that's hurting you the most? The non-importation agreements. So when push comes to shove, and we'll talk about this tomorrow, that's why this thing was repealed, because British merchants are feeling it, are they not? Because their biggest trade was with the colonies. And so British merchants are in shock at these colonial non-importation agreements, and it basically brought British-American trade to a standstill, and that's the pressure Parliament's getting, and we'll tell you what process they take to repeal this act. Okay? All right, perfect. Good job today. Keep those worksheets for your test now.